Okay, here we go. Hi everyone, welcome back to Seeker Plus and the final show in our series on the International Space Station. I'm Julian Huguet. If you haven't heard the first two episodes, why don't you go ahead and check them out? I'll be waiting here until you get back. I asked two astronauts about their new space toilet, and actually, if you'd believe it or not, it has something to do with the future of space travel. And Shane Kimbrough and Thomas Pesquet surprisingly didn't hang up on me after that. The ISS has been in orbit in one form or another for 23 years now. How many more does the station have? On paper, it doesn't look like many. The ISS is only possible because it's supported by 5 space agencies and 15 nations. That global partnership is set to end in 2024, which seems really soon. But you wouldn't know it based on the planned updates coming to the station. A major one just happened in July of 2021 when the new Russian module Naouka was added to the station. Naouka means science in Russian, so of course it includes a lab, as well as a living area and a toilet, as I'm sure many of you are happy to hear. It's the largest addition to the Russian side of the station since Zvezda was attached to the budding ISS over 2 decades ago. It might seem like strange timing to add such a large piece now, but Naouka was originally scheduled for launch back in 2007. It had some gremlins that kept causing technical issues and delayed its launch, and it seems like there are still some in there. The new module docked with the ISS without any issues, but after Naouka was secured to the ISS, the module's automated docking system seemed to think that it wasn't. Twice, Naouka has fired up its engines and spun the ISS around. NASA says it's nothing dangerous, but I'm sure it's not fun for the crew when their house makes an unscheduled flip. Aside from a fussy, overdue module, the ISS has some cutting-edge improvements on the docket. In 2022, the station will be adding new solar arrays. They'll be much more compact than the current massive and iconic arrays, but because they're much more efficient, they'll make a lot more power for the station. So much so that the plan is to place them in front of the existing panels. It'll reduce the power the old solars make, but the new panels will more than make up for it. And it's also just easier to attach them to something that's already tracking the sun. Finally, the station is scheduled to add another module, but this time not from Russia or NASA or any other space agency for that matter. This new piece is currently being built by Axiom Space, a private company based in Texas. Axiom Space plans to offer their section as a microgravity lab other companies can rent or an extremely high-end hotel room. And really, whoever takes a date there is going to put all the rest of us to shame. Axiom has big plans for their own section, stating they intend to double the usable volume of the ISS before eventually separating and operating on their own. Shane and Thomas share their thoughts on the future of the station with me.
Yeah, ISS is going to be around for a while. We certainly hope so. I think you're going to see a bigger commercial aspect of it over the next decade or so, which is, you know, really what we hope to do, make it more accessible to commercial companies to be able to use. And so we'll see how that plays out. I think that's the plan, at least from what I've heard, as we kind of take that next step to with the Artemis program going to the moon. We may still have a presence here in low Earth orbit, but in general, we want to move out and let the commercial companies and private companies maybe take over low Earth orbit.
As far as NASA is concerned, private companies taking over the ISS could work for them just fine. It would allow them to divest and focus their attention elsewhere. Where is elsewhere? The moon. In 2017, NASA announced its plans to return humans to the moon with the Artemis program. Fun fact, in Greek mythology, Artemis is the twin sister of Apollo, and aptly, the Artemis missions will send the first woman to the moon. One major piece of the Artemis puzzle is another space station called Gateway. But Gateway won't be orbiting the Earth, it'll be orbiting the Moon. Which I guess technically means it's also, you know, orbiting the Earth, but you know what I'm saying. Gateway could be an outpost that makes regular trips to the Moon possible, and it could be so much more. Artemis is targeting the moon's south pole as a destination because the south pole has water ice. That water could be used for drinking, reducing the amount of stuff astronauts have to bring with them each journey, always a huge plus. But the water at the moon's south pole could have another very important use. It could be used to make rocket fuel. If everything comes together, Gateway really could be a crucial pit stop on the way to other parts of the solar system. But being so much farther away from the Earth than the ISS is, it's vital that everything on Gateway goes right. Fortunately, the ISS has given astronauts and space agencies more than 2 decades of experience building and supporting a megastructure in space.
Yeah, I think it's fantastic because today all the major space agencies in the world have the same goal and they're working in common to achieve the same goal, which has never happened before, I think, to my knowledge. So I honestly think we'll get there in no time. And really the point is to go to the moon, but in a more sustainable, in a more permanent way than NASA did in the 70s. Because the point is to establish a common presence. It's always the same pattern. You send an explorer or explorers, you try to learn about the environment, then you settle and you try to have people live there and then you develop. And it has always happened like this on the globe, on the planet. And it has happened like this for low Earth orbit. We've now been living, astronauts have been living for more than 20 years in low Earth orbit permanently. So now we've kind of mastered this environment. It's a big word because it's still very difficult, but we're planning to repeat the same pattern on the moon. We've had explorers go to the moon, and now we want to go and stay. And then we'll send explorers to Mars, and then we'll go and stay. And part of that process is to learn how to make that happen. That's what we do every day on ISS. We're doing science that benefits the people on the ground, like we talked about before, but we're also doing exploration. We're trying to improve the technology. We're trying to improve the processes. We're trying to learn about the human body in space for extended periods of time. And all this that we're doing every day is going to enable us to go to the moon, go to Mars. Shane mentioned the solar arrays, the toilet, generally speaking, the life support system, all the systems that are going to be needed to take that major next step. We're testing them, we're establishing them, we're learning about them on the space station today.
Gateway will once again require a multinational effort to work, and the space agencies of Europe, Japan, and Canada are already on board with NASA. But you may have noticed one agency from the ISS partnership is missing. Russia will leave the group and has announced plans to partner with China to build a lunar research station of their own. 2024 may not be the definite end of the ISS. The United States has proposed extending its life to 2030. But reaching that goal depends on if the station and the political partnerships supporting it are structurally sound. And if I had to bet which one of those crumbles first, I know what my money's on. It's no secret that the relationship between Russia and the USA has been strained in recent years. Ironically, the station that was born when two enemies warmed up to each other may meet its end when the relationship goes cold once again. Regardless of when or why, there is one truth that we'll all have to come to terms with, and that is someday the ISS is going to come back down to Earth. It may be 420 kilometers up, but even that high, there are still air molecules bumping into it and slowing it down. Without a boost, it'll eventually fall down on its own, but that's really not the preferred method. Remember America's first space station, Skylab, I mentioned? Its operational life was supposed to be extended with a boost from the space shuttle, only the space shuttle wasn't ready by the time gravity and friction got the better of it. It came crashing back down in 1979, and despite the best efforts of NASA ground controllers to steer it into the Indian Ocean, some debris was scattered across southwest Australia. In typical Aussie fashion, the town of Esperance fined NASA $400 for littering. That's my favorite space anecdote of all time. For the ISS, the space shuttle would be helpful for avoiding another fine with a controlled deorbit, but once again, the space shuttle isn't flying. NASA says they're working out with its partners how to deorbit the station safely when the time comes, but there's no details on exactly how they'll do it. And maybe it's for the best, because personally, I'd really rather not picture the end. When it's all said and done, how will we look back on the ISS? Where does it fit in the ongoing story of the human race? Perhaps there's no better people to answer that question than those who actually built it and call it home.
If you think about the engineering that was involved in creating the station for one, but then, you know, all these different countries that were involved that had to have pieces that put, you know, this module had to fit to an American module, which had to fit to a European module. And none of that was ever put together on planet Earth, right? So just things like that. And it just amazes me how these incredible engineers and scientists got together, created this plan, and it works so well. At that level. So that's pretty neat, I think, overall as well, when you think about where this fits in. It's an engineering marvel, for one. It's an incredible place to do world-class research, which is what it's completely designed for, and we're in that research phase, and we have been the last several years. So it's really special.
I think it's significant, maybe more than people realize. The ISS is the time when humans in general stopped being bound to Earth, and they started to be not multiplanetary, but not strictly on one planet species. Like I said, we've had humans live in space for 20 years, so now part of humanity is not only strictly on Earth, but also in space. And the first step of this is really the ISS. That's the ISS, that big permanent space station that enables us to live in space. So the ISS is pretty significant because, you know, 100 years when hopefully maybe the human beings are on other planets, then you'll look back and you'll look at the ISS as the starting point of this. That's the time when humans freed themselves up from the cradle of the Earth and started really venturing to space to live, not just to see what it's like and come back.
That was all the time I had with Shane and Tamah. Our phone call started with them off the coast of Morocco, and by the time it ended, they had just passed Cape Town, South Africa. It was now officially the longest distance call I'd ever made. 20 minutes... and they'd gone so far. And in 20 years, the ISS has too. Well, that's going to do it for this episode of Seeker Plus. Be sure to tune in for the next one when we learn about learning. I think I'm going to have a little lie down, maybe weep about a giant aluminum can in space, but after I get over that, I will see you next time on Seeker Plus.